Dear friends, dear attendees of this evening's lecture, a very warm welcome to you all. My name is Jerke Verschoor and I'm the director of the Netherlands Education Support Office with yet another one of our Dutch science talks. I hope you can hear me, I hope you can see me. Please confirm so in the chat and perhaps also mention from what city you are listening in. I see a plus from Alexei. Thank you, Alexei. So Tula. Very good. So I see that I can be heard and seen. Again, a very warm welcome. Please use the chat box also for when you have questions during the lecture by Aliki van der Kruis. But before we go to her, I would like to welcome the cultural attaché of the Netherlands Embassy in Moscow, Mrs. Janette Verrijzer, with whom we run this program. And she will give an introduction of the topic and the speaker. I wish you all a very nice lecture. Janette, the floor is yours.
Hello, thank you, Jerke, and welcome everyone to this Dutch science talk, which is about design. Design is not only about objects, it is also about thinking. Thinking about the future and making life better for all of us. Dutch design studios are working around the world on very different topics. They bring us smart and fun ideas that tackle the most important global challenges. They think about upgrading cities, renovating buildings, creating physical or virtual public spaces, or making new apps. They also produce new ways of creating new technology, like in the case of Aliki van der Kruis, innovative fabrics. Whatever designers invent, they are always intent at making the world around us cleaner, safer, gentler, and altogether a better place. I hope that you will be inspired by Aliki today and see what design can do. Aliki van der Kruis is a Dutch artist who, as she says herself, thinks through textile. She is currently a resident at the Jan van Eyck Academy in Maastricht, and she has experience working with companies like Nike, Wolf Gordon, and Zigzag Zurich. She is also part of the artist collective The Weavers Werkstatt, and her work is already in the collections of the Cooper Hewitt Design Museum in New York, the Textile Museum in Tilburg, other museums, the Dutch Minister of Infrastructure and Water, and in the collection of private collectors. She is working on some very cool projects, so I do hope that you will have, at least on this online meeting, a chance to see what she's doing. Aliki, thank you, and the floor is yours.
Hello, everybody. I will check if people can hear me.
Yes.
Cool. Okay. Then I click away the chat. I'm Aliki, and I will navigate you through a selection of my portfolio in the coming minutes, like a small, like 45 minutes. I hope I will go through it. And I will share my screen now. Okay, so I'm Aliki, and here you see me in the surrounding of Maastricht, where I'm at the moment based because I do a residency here. And this residency is gives me the opportunity to reflect on my practice, to make new work, but also to live in a very beautiful surrounding where there's a landscape where I do research too. And I will show you a line of projects that actually started after seeing this blue pigment somewhere in a Dutch museum. But first I would like to say my background is in fashion design. I studied at Artes, the fashion school where Victor and Rolf and other big names graduated. And that was a very good study for me. I learned so much about textiles and about color and about time. The sense of time, but I was never really interested in the runway image. And I was really interested in fabrics and what fabrics can tell and mean and how they support the body, but also how they make space. So I actually always felt like I would like to work around text, around fashion and not in fashion. So after my graduation, I worked for G-Star, the denim company, where I did a lot of really nice material research, It was a dream job back then, but I thought, oh, I would have a job like that in 10 years and I already have it. But I also felt there was like something more from myself that I had to explore. So I went to the Sandberg Institute where I came actually into a way of working where the textiles and my love for photography are combined. And in the first year, I did this project called Weathering Blue, where I actually looked if I can really literally use textiles as a photography medium. And this all started because I got the question to make a project around crafts and about all disappearing crafts. And because of my work experience at G-Star, I looked at the old craft of the laundry, like how you clean textiles, inspired by the fact that at G-Star, where they make denims, like jeans, they fake in the factory that they are look old. So I was always a little bit like, questioning the fact that you already buy an old aged garment. So I wanted to give this notion of time myself to the textiles. And another thing that I was inspired by is the bleach fields, what they also used, like really literally putting the textiles outside on the grass, because they with the sunlight it the textiles become more white. And what they used to use, this blue pigment that you saw before, they used to use that in the laundry to make textiles look more optical white. And also, if you have washing powder these days, there's little blue dots in it, and these are the blue pigment, which used to be a stone, like a ground stone. The lapis lazuli stone, but nowadays it's synthesized, and then it took a whole revolution in using this pigment in the laundry industry. And so I went into this color, and I forgot to say that I did this research in the Zuiderzee Museum, which is a historical museum in the Netherlands, about how people used to live around the Zuiderzee, which is the Netherlands used to have a sea inside the land. So I did a lot of investigation into the surrounding of the water and the sky, and how the water was influenced to this old city. And I had a residency there where I had a little house where I used a little house as a workshop. And what I found out, and it's in Dutch, but it says fixation and pH. So I did a study in how the pH, like the acidity of water, changes actually how textile or how color is binded to textile. And you see a little house there with gutters and barrels of what, like rain barrels. And they used to have in the houses in the Netherlands a gutter that now you see it facing outside, but it could also turn inside. And what they did is that when wind and rain came from the sea, they would put the gutter outside, and then it would stream the salty water outside in the barrel. And when the rain came from inland, they would turn it the other way around. And then you had, let's say, clean water to do the household with. So I was fascinated by this pH, but also by the color, because the effect that you would put blue into your wash to make it look white, that, I don't know, this contrast stood by with me. And then I decided to react also on the garments that workers used to wear. And I played with this idea of this white color and the blue color society. So what I did is I painted a shirt, like the patterns of a shirt, around 1900, I painted totally blue with the pigment, and then I put it outside on the dike. There was we made a clothesline. I exposed it per day to the elements, and I had a residency of 158 days. And I had a kind of scheme where different textiles would go in and go out. So then I harvested, let's say, the textiles, and then I made a shirt from it with a pattern from 2014. And so like almost 100 years of difference of pattern, and people in 100 years they grew a little bit, so the sleeves, for instance, were a little bit longer, and you get a different pocket position, so you see this fading element inside the pocket. And there was also a storm one day, and all my textiles were really teared apart, and they were all everywhere in the museum of, surrounding the dike. So, and funnily enough, it was really a happy accident. Like the middle front of the garment was exactly torn apart. And what I did is I captured the time, and it's, I could have, for instance, put a camera on the work. But I wanted to actually have the textiles themselves become the documentation. So what I did is I asked people in the museum, the visitors of the museum, to send me pictures of how they witnessed the textiles. And all the lines that you see in the poster are the wind direction, the temperature. So it's actually a weather station. When I was doing that project, I was witnessing the textiles becoming wet when it started to rain. And personally, I'm very fan of the rain. I like patterns, and I really like it that the rain almost imprints space. Or I don't know, that if you cycle in the Netherlands on a bicycle and you get wet, and your coat has this kind of dry area, and your trouser is only wet on the bottom, so all this imprints movement I'm fascinated by. So I was documenting these droplets, but of course when the sun came it disappeared again. So I thought, like, okay, how can we really wear the weather? When I was doing the previous project, the Weathering Blue, my uncle gave me some calendars of my grandfather, where he wrote on every day the weather. But it was also that I thought, like, oh, but these days people look at radar apps to see what the weather is or will be. And so I think people don't really understand anymore how the atmosphere is working. And also the textiles, or the rain, is archived just by numbers. And I'm going to show you a movie with the process, and then I come back to you. If you have questions, by the way, really ask in the chat, and then we can get back to that. To maybe explain a little bit more about how I make the textiles, and what I call analog version and what I call digital version. Here you see the analog version, where I use paper, and you see, there's it's a white textile with a black paper underneath, and slowly, when the rain comes, you would have this black becoming more vibrant and more wet, so it takes in the textile that's above. And this one I started making in the textile museum, and here you see also, like, the small bottom pictures are a little bit like in the photography in the doka, or like in the darkroom. You can see from left to right that there was no rain 1 minute, 2, 3, 4 minutes of rain. So it's kind of it's not a light, it's like a rain test of how like a gradient in time. And these textiles, like these ones, are not able to be, not, I cannot fix them, but I wanted to really make something that really people can use or wear. So I needed to have a fixed textile, and these textiles I fix, and then you can wear it. So it's not only rain, this was a hail series. When I go, for instance, when I went to New York, I always take textiles with me just in case it rains. And I try to be very precise on the data information, but I also wasted quite some textiles when I started to become very time strict. So now I do it very also on aesthetics, or what is a beautiful textile. But then I just recalculate the given information. Now I write it on, not silkscreen anymore, so it's a stamp, and but still I write every part that is changing. And when you buy a textile, you get a piece like this. So this is the document with a picture of the sky, and all the symbols are actually the how do you say? Like a musician reads chords. This is how a meteorologist reads information about what kind of weather it is. So it's a series of scarves, which has both a front and a back side, which are have their own quality. This is the book I showed in the movie. I also made a series of curtains. This was in an exhibition. I had some private clients making curtains, or that I made curtains for. I collaborated with Elsien Ginghuis. She's a Dutch designer, a fashion designer, who's only working with ecological materials. And the cape on the right, we coated with beeswax, which made it a very beautiful, wet kind of feeling. Nike bought a print, Zigzag Zurich has a, you can sleep in the ring. And these are all with the analog version. So I've never reproduced the digital ones, because these are really one-on-one imprints, but the more free patterning, that I think it's okay to reproduce. And I have a website made by rain.com, where it's also, when it rains in my studio, there's a rain radar going over it. So it's a webshop slash archive. And then the next one, Botanical Habit. When I graduated, we at the Sandberg Institute, our location was the botanical garden of the hospital. And back then, it was on the list to be demolished, this location, because the hospital was expanding. And like the botanical garden is actually the source of medicine. So I thought, again, there was this contradiction where I reacted on, is that the hospital was expanding, but like demolishing their own source, let's say. So all the plants had to move and to go somewhere else. I was also back then asked, like, how can you activate your process more or share it? And then I wanted to document the plants that were on the list to move, but without making pictures on them. Like, I wanted to, have a contact imprint with the plants. So I covered them with the analog version. And in the greenhouse, there was a rain system, so I could turn on the rain. And then you have all these different plants. Sorry, this is a movie that's not working. But in this movie, you see it, it's raining. Can I click? No. So these were some of the imprints. And these I framed because they are more like documents. And it's very beautiful because even the veins are captured in the textile. So this is framed. So this is more an art project. And again, I made a book. I think every time I make a book to show the variety of outputs that I come up with in my field work. But it also keeps track on thoughts, or it's a good way to share my research. And then another thing about water, it's Cadence 2.0, because it's an extended version of a previous project we did together. And in an other exhibition, I don't show you now, but I met Jos. And Jos is has a background in mathematics and the Design Academy in Eindhoven. And in 2015, I moved to Den Haag, which is near the sea, but I used to live more in the east in the Netherlands, in Amsterdam. And then I was in the newspaper, I read about the stick chart that you see on the left, which comes from people from the Marshall Islands. And there is a group of navigators who can read the sea very from a bodily experience. So they don't need any tools, no compass. They just they are trained to read the waves, to read the sky, the stars, to listen to the wind, to listen to how the waves come bounce to the boat. So I was very aware that I'm living next to the sea, but I have no clue if I could ever, like, I can even survive there. And I also had this map on the right, and it's a silk map. It's actually an escape map, and it shows on two sides of the silk. It's printed with the streams of the sea, and in the Second World War, people would hide them in the lining of their coats in order that, to know how they could escape and know what the tides are on a specific time. And then I also had this question, like, the sea is always in motion, and you hardly see the change between. It's almost like a big blanket to see, but you don't have the notion that it moves up and down, or that it's and also these days with sea level rising, I was just curious what is actually the effect of this rising water, and can we map that in a specific way? And I really felt the urge to look or investigate if it's possible to weave water. And when I met Jos, we had similar interests, and then I asked, shall we weave water together? So we started the project, and then we first did an investigation of what is actually a watery textile and how do you represent textiles, water. And then Jos made a map of all the points in the Dutch North Sea where information is registered about, like, various input of wave length, wave height, as the saltness of the sea, wind direction. And we went into the mathematics of oceanographers. So we did a whole broad research also. We consulted oceanographers from the TU Delft. And with all this information, we started to make a weaving software. Jos is the brain behind that. I'm more into the textiles and the yarns, but I can think with him on an abstract level, but he's more the coder. And together with R&DR, it's a studio in The Hague who creates software, we really came to two weaving programs where we can import data from the Rijkswaterstaat, and then you would have a never-ending textile code. And so this is actually then our base or our station. So we would have all this data coming in, we would put it in our software, and then I would weave it out. You see it again. But that's also like, how can this sea be translated into something new? And then we were invited by Hella Jongerius to become part of the Weavers Werkstatt. So we went to her exhibition in Lafayette Anticipation. It was in Paris, where we could work 3 weeks on the TC2, which is like a jacquard hand loom. And here you see me weaving, and which helped our research very much because we could make a lot of sampling. And on the left, you see the loom I have in my studio, which is a shaft loom, which has a more rigid pattern outcome. And on the right, it's the textile museum where we also wove textiles. So these are some of the samples. And it's really an investigation how you translate this data and without being photographic, because we could also, for instance, make a picture of the sea and then weave that, but that's, we really wanted to have the essence and how things evolve and change over time. So we actually were looking for a visual language that made it happen. So this is a selection of textiles. And what we did in order to show the potential of actually using this data is that we every time we wove three times. So we took a moment of when the sea was very low, middle and high, then we would weave all those patterns. So we have a kind of a segment from a specific time frame. And then you can also compare how the one design, let's say, works different than another one. Like on the right, it's like a twill, a variation on a twill, which is a very much more simple output. And on the left, it's more like as if you look from above, from the sea. Because we also use a computer program that oceanographers use to simulate the sea. So we combine different elements. And here you see a very simple, like it's a 10 shaft woolen woven piece in Italy. It's like woven on a 1900 loom, which has a different outcome, but you do see the difference. Like on the top there's middle sea, in the middle it's low sea, and on the bottom it's high sea. And here also again some sampling. So there we also have a website, cadence.com, and there you can also see the software and read more about the project. And we have two interviews with people that helped us in the making of the project. And then Jos and I found out that it's that we really work easy together, and that it's really nice to work together, and that we have two different skills that are very well combined. And I got the question from an architect duo in Amsterdam, Rademacher de Vries, to design to help design the new interior of the office of the Stimuleringsfonds voor Creatieve Industrie. It's like the Dutch funding for designers and architects and digital culture. And you see on the right the view of their office, which was in the initial, before the renovation, all the windows were closed off by rooms. So you had no really view on the city. It's on the fifth fifth floor of a building, and you can really see beautiful over Rotterdam skyline. I got the question, and then I thought, okay, I have to work with Jos on this, because it's again about motion and about something that is changing. And you saw it already in the beginning of my presentation, this cyanometer on the left, which is an invention from like 1760. Cyanometer is also used by Humboldt, the explorer who was the inspiration for Darwin to start writing his work. So he took it on all his travels to see how blue the sky is. And the sky is not always blue, so I was also wondering like why is the sky blue? But why we chose to work with the sky in this location is because the building, the map or the floor plan was exactly facing north. So you on once and there were two, there was really a north-faced window and a south-faced window part. And on the east and west, there were no windows. So on the outside, with the concept, okay, then I should make a kind of sundial or something that says something about how the sun moves around. And then Jos and I started to work. And then actually we came up, you see on the right, left, these color bars are different zones of how daylight, data information. Sorry, it's a data representation of sunlight, and then you see the middle one is Malaysia, and then the one on the left, it's Reykjavik, which has very short, like it has no sunlight at all in the winter, and very long days in this in the summer, and Malaysia is always the same because it's on the equator. So also in the Netherlands there's this rhythm of day and night light, night sky, so we reacted on that. And there's a lot of pollution, of light pollution in the night in Rotterdam. So yeah, we went into this investigation of how the sky is colored. And then we wanted to construct our own colors. So again, we went to the textile museum and we started weaving. But the textile, it was a super good way of making colors. But for the space, it was too heavy, the fabric. So what we did is we translated all these scattering and noisy patterns, because that's, sorry, I forgot to say that, it's railing scattering. The sun, the sky is blue because there's a lot of dust in the sky, and the sun is on a specific angle, and then it makes a blue color. And here we made some, it's a palette of different colors for different parts of the day. And here you see a sketch of a circle of the textiles. Because there was we enclosed a meeting room. So we made a curtain which was 360 degrees. It can go all the way around. So it would make the space, you can change the space constantly, and the curtains can almost like a sun go around this meeting room. And I don't know, so here you have a little bit an impression of how this works in the space. And here just the other sides. It seems like a solid color or like a gradient, but if you come closer, and here you see more the palette of the lighter colors and of the more day and evening colors, but if you come close, it's all constructed from pixels. And it also came from, because I read somewhere that light weaves colors, which I thought was a very nice saying. And because we really looked at the angle of the sun on a specific moment, we, just like with the textiles of Cadence and also with my Made Bahrain textiles, everything is coded from this specific moment, which is very subtle on the bottom of the curtain, but still the data is present. And that was it. And I'm very looking forward to your questions.
Thank you very much, Aliki. It was really fascinating, I have to say. And I think I speak for all of us. Please, post-pandemic, come to Russia and we'll all go out with you on a roof when it's raining. So thank you very much. There are questions, so I will, and Janette, if you want, you can already join, of course. Maybe it's nice, you, Janette, had a cultural attaché for many years already in Moscow, and dealing a lot with designers also in Russia. I'll start with the first question that was posed, Aliki. Mm-hmm. In the beginning, when you described the project Made by Rain, you use the term fix it, and mm-hmm. there was some confusion. What it is? Is it a chemical step, or what did you mean by it?
Well, the textiles are like, because I only fix the digital process, so the textiles are printed on an inkjet printer, like they're prepared and are still not fixed. So I put them in the rain and then I put them inside again, let them dry, and then I fix it by steaming. And the inks are reactive inks, so that means that the textile has a kind of solution. That when it becomes hot, the ink goes in the fiber, and or the fiber opens, the ink comes in, so it's captured. And then if you wash, the ink is really inside the fiber. And I don't know if people are aware or like experienced with textile printing, but with silkscreen, for instance, there's really a layer on the textile, And with my textiles, it's really inside the yarn. So it's there's no, you don't feel the ink or the color. So I hope that explains it.
Thank you. And then Janet, if you have a question, do let me know. There was a question by Natalia, two questions actually. She was wondering, are all these patterns, and it seems like they were they unique? And do you use only natural textiles?
Well, I use for the scarves silk, which is, yeah, I rather have a more eco-friendly material. But the thing is that I did a lot of investigation, it's also visible in my book, about what textile works the best. But for instance, if you have a cotton or even a linen, the binding is quite, let's say, big, or that the threads are very bigger than with silk. So the droplets are not so sharp. So I always say that it becomes more low res, let's say. And silk is so fine woven that it's almost like a high res. Like it's really, even if you talk and you have a little dot on it, it's still visible. So it's a hypersensitive textile. Yeah. And then the other, like I'm wearing my scarves already like for 5-6 years already. So it's a very, it's quite a heavy silk, but that makes it also, like I wear it every day. It's a strong silk. So that's, yeah. I'm happy with that. Yeah.
And again, all the patterns are unique, right?
Yes. Because that's another thing. Like I also, people said like, you can just print, like you make one and then you do a repetition and then you can like sell them very commercial, which is against my ethics, my own work ethics, let's say. But also then you lose the quality of the two sides because then it really comes just a print. And I really wanted to have contact with the rain. So.
Thank you. Janette?
Yes, thank you, Aliki. It was very fascinating to see what you've been doing and what you are doing. I have two questions. One is, you mentioned the project in the Hortus, which was an art project. You also sold your print, or you sold one print to Nike and to the other company. Is that two parts in your body that live there and live life together, or is that one Aliki that works sometimes commercially or sometimes artistically, or do you just need to sell something to buy your food? That's one thing. I'm sure you can say something about it. And the other thing is, I saw that you also had an exposition in the Emirates. I can imagine that the attitude towards rain is very different in different countries. Do people like rain more if it's rare, or do people in the Netherlands like it more? I'm sure you can say something about that as well. Thank you.
I will first reply to that question. Yes, people react very differently to rain. Actually, my strongest experience is with Japanese people, that they react very strongly. I feel that they have a really different sensibility of rain, and I didn't show, but I also made a ceramic series with rain, because in Japan they have even more than 50 nouns to describe the rain. Like in the Netherlands we have like maybe 5 words, let's say. We don't have this really embodied notion of how a drop falls on a leaf and then on the ground, or like it's super precise, or it comes from left or from right, or so that was in Japan. In I was not in Dubai myself, so I have unfortunately had no chance to talk with people about it. But the funny thing is that if I travel, people always say, you're in the Netherlands, it's a really bad weather, which I think it's not that so, not so bad, but I think what I really enjoy, and because I also feel that it's very universal. Like if people see the textiles in an exhibition and then they read Made by Rain, you really see like boom, like a connection, and then they say, wow. So some people say, I even hear the rain when I look at your textile. So I'm very happy that it's what it brings to people. And then the other question is indeed, and that's also maybe why I'm at Jan van Eyck, to really find this balance between art and design. And I'm trained as a designer, of course, but I do have a lot of autonomous projects. And I'm inspired by the weaver Annie Albers, who literally was working on one warp where she was making her like her own autonomous work, but also her work for companies. And I think I'm at the moment doing a lot of autonomous work, which feels that I can extract essences from and apply it again in companies. Because I hope that also through my work, I can enrich also the, like say, commercial part of how people look at things. Yeah, so that feel, and of course I need to eat as well. Yes, and I have to sustain my artistic practice. I think it really influences each other, because if I do only commercial work, I cannot, I don't know. It's for me, it's important to do this next to each other, yeah.
Thank you, Aliki. One more question about the Made by Rain project. The questions before I asked were by Alexei and Natalia. And Alexei wanted to also know if there is a difference between a warm and a cold rain. Does a spring rain differ from the autumn one?
The intensity and the drips, yes, but not the warmth, like of the ink is not reacting to the degrees of the rain water, no.
Okay. But
I do, because I thought I knew Dutch rain, I knew rain because I did so many imprints. But then I was in Japan, and then I had this rain coming from like an orkan or like a
tornado or a...
No, the with it. This big rain. I don't know what
the monsoon, something like that.
It's also not monsoon, but it's like this third orkan. I don't know, but a very heavy rain, and then
a hurricane.
A hurricane. Yes.
Yes. Thank you, Alexei.
So then I was like, "Whoa, my God, this is so different rain." So there is really a difference in rain everywhere in the Netherlands. That's why, yeah. I would like to make this atlas.
Yeah. And then the question from the Russian audience, from Yelena, what about snow?
Yes, that's a good question, but it's a total different... Yeah, then I should go to Russia. The thing is that also the best, I think the nicest imprints are when you hear the rain falling like when you really hear it, the rain falling, because when the rain is drizzly, you hardly see an effect on the textile. So snow would be, it would touch too soft, yep. But I think it would be, then it will be about melting, I guess, yep. Or about pressure or, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. One more question that partly already was answered by the question that Janette asked. I will read it anyway, and then maybe we can change it a bit. Alexandra asked, does any big and well-known retail brands use your textiles, or is it more for private entrepreneurs? Now, we know that some prints were bought by Nike, and we saw your project, which I also really liked, the curtain in Rotterdam. But maybe we can also ask you, are you approached often by bigger retail brands or?
Sometimes, but then they also realize that it's not so easy to scale into this huge industrial needs. And so then it would always become maybe the print that Nike did. So no, I didn't, I'm, there's no real big collaboration in that way.
But you do work then with the private sector, the private entrepreneurs, if they come with a single request.
Yes, yeah.
And one question, which I find very beautiful, by Daria. She asked, how many years do you create this beauty? Did you know at the beginning that you would be popular with these designs?
Oh, no. No. And I think, I didn't know. Because I know that there's a lot of students that this project really came from from a real big curiosity. And I think that helps a lot with bringing the message across, because and it's this universal language, let's say. But the thing is that I always wanted to become a world traveler, let's say, or like a world explorer, and this project helps me to do it. So that's very nice.
Yeah, very nice. Janette, would you have another question?
No.
If not, no.
Maybe an advice that Aliki can give to students that aspire to do her work.
You mean to become a designer or to make Made by Rain?
not a copycat, but.
But I'm sure there are students in the audience who want to be a designer.
Yeah. An advice, yeah. But like, I'm very. I think I've learned the most when I didn't listen to my teachers, let's say, or when I really stepped out of the process. Because for me, it was always difficult when I'm too much, how do you say? I'm at my best if I listen really to myself and go my own direction. Because I'm now, of course, 10 years graduated almost from my Sandberg, and I graduated in 2007 from Arnhem, which is a long time already. But I also, like, it was very tough and in the beginning, but I always felt like I need this long, because it feels that now things come together, and that having all these projects in line and having all these watery investigation of textiles, water, the environment, that now people start to see what I do. But in the beginning, it was ploeteren, let's say. It's a Dutch, yeah. I don't know what in English.
Hard work to get where you are now, so to say.
Yes, yeah. But I also really, like, I did it from my heart, so I think that's also very important.
Yeah. I would have one more question, but there's one, I think suggestion comes up now, perhaps by Katarina, perhaps there's a way to create texture of frost on the textile, like on windows.
Yeah. Yes, it's really, really good idea.
But maybe you could, can you give us a glimpse in what you are working on now, or what we could expect from you in the near future?
At the moment, I'm doing more research. There's a big quarry here in the surrounding, where they really literally dig a big hole in the earth. So I'm doing investigation tomorrow, and to stones and to. I think it's a combination of this end, this pixel of color, building colors, but that's from stone colors and really looking into the structure of how. I'm going more into the microscopic way of how everything is constructed.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much. Aliki, we have a lot of really nice and positive comments in the chat. So they really, I myself, I liked it very much as well. So thank you once more. And as Janette said earlier, we hope to be able to invite you to come to Moscow and take some of your samples.
That's a shame that you cannot, because textile is so tactile, you really would like to take it in your hands. And
yes, and I think we all have that feeling now that we want to have those curtains. So thank you very much, Aliki. Thank you also, Janette, for the support of the Netherlands Embassy.
Thank you,
dear audience. Yeah. Thank you for the questions of the audience. Please stay connected with us. We'll have more lectures upcoming, still online, unfortunately. We look very much forward to seeing you again in our next lecture. And we will, of course, let you know whenever we will go physical again and invite people to come to Moscow. Thank you very much. With this, it comes to an end. And I wish everybody a very nice evening.
Bye, everyone.
Thank you very much.
Thank you both. Bye-bye. I will close down this session.